Robert, the question that has haunted me literally my entire life since I was a young teenager thinking about these things is, why is there anything at all? Not just an empty universe and how stars came about, but why is there anything, any laws, anything, any God, anything? Because it just seems intrinsically that nothing, absolutely nothing, is more simple than anything else.
Well, I think that you have discovered the presupposition that makes the question of why is there anything at all so vexing, because nothing does seem simpler than anything else, except for, perhaps, absolute simplicity.
But that's nothing.
Well, no. I would maintain absolute simplicity as power without an intrinsic or extrinsic restriction.
Wow, that sounded very good. A lot of somethings.
Yeah. Well, actually, it's not a lot.
A lot of somethings.
I would just say simply this. I would say, why assume that nothing is the condition that demarcates, as it were, the eternal existence of everything? All right. Let's suppose for just a moment that there was something like absolute simplicity. What gives us the problem is really finite realities, because finite realities then imply something beyond that finitude, or finite realities may have a beginning, and the beginning seems to indicate that there has to be something else beyond it, and so forth and so on. And so my thought is, you know, if you really have an unrestricted reality, which is not a lot of some things, it's not a lot of finite realities, it's a perfect simplicity, it's a perfect unity, then perhaps perfect unitive reality, something which exists through itself, is the primordial and, as it were, eternal now existent, and that nothing is only the result of our reflecting on what's outside of the boundaries of finite reality. In other words, we've come up with zero, you know, as it were, in response to conceiving of the problem of finitude. But if you start with, well, wait a minute, why wouldn't an unrestricted power be, you know, reality itself? Why wouldn't that be the natural condition of all else that is? Okay, go ahead.
If I am in this universe right now, it may make more sense to have a something behind this universe, because I know that exists. But if I were looking at it purely a priori, if I didn't know this universe exists and I wasn't in it, this is kind of ridiculous. Wheels within itself. But stepping outside, it would seem to me, if I were given a choice in this kind of absurd situation, between nothing being the most simple and an unrestricted, unbounded, simplistic reality being the primordial existent, I would pick nothing.
Yeah, I mean, I can see why you'd do it, because, of course, you'd think, well, there's no presuppositions in nothing. But what I would want to suggest is there are no presuppositions in perfect simplicity, a perfect unitive, unrestricted power either. There's absolutely no presupposition. And I think the thing that's just driving you is when you get to that thing of choosing between nothing and something, nothing always seems to have far less presuppositions than perfect, simplistic, unitive a reality or power. And the thought I'm just going to bring home to you is, if you really did have something that was truly absolutely simple, had no intrinsic or extrinsic boundaries whatsoever, which was a completely unconditioned reality, there wouldn't be a single presupposition that attached itself to that reality, and that reality could clean out exist in a presuppositionless environment, tantamount to the nothing.
If I have that thing that you've just described, I don't know whether to call it a thing, but your the thing you described, wouldn't I ask, why does that exist?
Actually, you wouldn't have to, because it would exist through itself.
No, I mean, that's an answer to the question, but I still have to ask the question.
Yeah, you.
If it's nothing, I don't have to ask a question.
Yeah, but actually, to be honest with you, if you understood it in itself,
Yes. You
would understand that it was presuppositionless, and therefore that you wouldn't have to ask the question. Because,
but I can't understand it in itself. But I can't.
You can't, and that's why you have to think.
You can't either.
Well, no, I know I can't. But at least I can conceive of what a presuppositionless reality would be, you know, as it were, working backwards. So you know, through the via negativa, I can tell you what it's not.
Right.
And so,
but you're still winding up with something.
You're still winding up with something.
You agree you have a something.
I agree I have a something. Okay. But
your something is, you think, is more,
is just as presuppositionless as nothing.
Yes.
And therefore, you know, I have to assume that the presuppositionless something has to be, as it were, the ground of reality. Because as you already suggested, we have something.
Yeah. Now that I know, and I concede we have something.
Yeah.
And once I concede that, I would move. If these two things are close, if nothing is close to your something in terms of being devoid of presuppositions, if that were the case, then I would concede because we have something, then yes, that's more likely. But if we didn't have something, or I didn't know we had something, and I was somehow outside this whole system, which is impossible, but nonetheless, I'd still pick nothing.
The problem is a limitation to our understanding. Really, I think you're exceedingly close to God. I think you're coming.
Nobody's ever accused me of that.
No, I know. But I think you are. I think you are busy trying to get to what's presuppositionless. And I guess here's a three-step process for future reflection. Step number one.
I'm counting.
Okay. Step number one is think of a reality that you can work backwards to. So just say unrestricted no intrinsic, extrinsic restrictions to the power. Then secondly, conceive of that as being unconditioned, that it can exist through itself, in a pure unity and pure simplicity. Then, you know, the ancients would call this kind of a hyperactive way. Then the third thing is just try, even though you have to approach it from the vantage point of a via negativa, I have to take away every image. I've got to take away the spatial manifold. I got to take away the temporal manifold. But just think for a second, every time I'm taking away one of these things that is restricting it, I'm also taking away a presupposition. Now take them all away. Third step, I'll take everything away. Every single thing that can cause a restriction, that is everything then that can cause a presupposition. And at that point, reflectively, even though you had to approach it via the via negativa, this, you still can get to that point where you almost can sort of see for a glimmer of a second something presuppositionless as nothing. And if that's the case, all of a sudden the quandary, great quandary that it is, begins to dissipate. And that's why there's room for reality and not just nothing.